I'm Allison Berman with Singularity Hub, and we are live at Exponential Manufacturing Conference in Boston. And to kick things off, I have Ramaz Naam here with me, who's a computer scientist, also a futurist, and an award-winning author of the Nexus Trilogy and Infinite Resources. He's also faculty at SU focused on environmental systems.
Hi, Allison.
Welcome.
Thanks. Good to be here.
So, starting big picture, manufacturing is an industry that's known to have a really large environmental footprint. What are some of the newer technologies that are helping to lessen this footprint?
Yeah. So manufacturing is about 20% of the world's carbon emissions, and that correlates how much energy it uses and also air pollution. And we've got to cut our carbon emissions by about a factor of 5 over the next 35, 40 years. It's a very, very steep decline. And really the best thing that we can do in manufacturing that meets self-interest too is efficiency. Efficiency is the cheapest energy. Like often, a efficiency gain, installing more efficient equipment, will not just be good for the environment, but will make a profit for the company. And a lot of the issue is just how do you finance it? You need to like get the upfront cost paid for, but then it will return its investment over several years.
And so then, speaking about corporations, what do you think has been like a roadblock in companies making more sustainable choices?
It's been economics. We know that there's abundant clean energy around us. The sun hits our planet with 10,000 times as much energy as we use from all sources combined every minute, but it's been expensive energy. And if you're a manufacturer, you have to go with what's cheapest if you want to provide the product that you're making at a low cost. But that's changing rapidly now. Now, in sunny parts of the world, solar is the cheapest energy, and in windy parts of the world, wind is the cheapest energy. So something that roadblock is disappearing.
And so speaking about solar energy and wind energy, your presentations always have these amazing statistics. Can you talk a bit about like where solar stands? Like what are some things that we're seeing in solar energy or in other clean technologies?
Yeah, it's been an amazing few years, an amazing decade. If you look further out, like from the 70s, the cost of 1 watt of solar panel has dropped by a factor of 200.
Wow. Right?
That's more like the change in cell phones than the change in factories or roads. And now, in sunny parts of the world, let's say natural gas costs 5 or 6 cents per unit of electricity, per kilowatt hour. In Dubai, they just signed a deal for solar at 2.4 cents, less than half the cost of natural gas or coal. And that's really just happened in the last 3-4 years that we've seen the price of solar has plunged by about a factor of 3 in that time, and has led to these breakout prices. So now, if you want to buy the cheapest electricity, to put your factory in a place that's really sunny or a place that's really windy, because you'll sign deals there that are just far cheaper than you can get from gas or coal.
And what are some of the things that are influencing this massive decrease in cost of solar?
It's really about the manufacturing side. So the solar panels themselves are getting cheaper. They're getting better, but mostly it's that we're making factories that can make them cheaper and cheaper and cheaper. Those factories are hitting larger scale. If you get bigger scale, the cost comes down. They're able to do the production more efficiently. They cut things thinner, they use less energy, less silicon, and so that drives a huge reduction in price. But the important thing here is that more scale brings down the prices, but more price, lower price also means you can sell more of it. So there's this positive feedback loop that's happening, that as solar gets cheaper, we sell more and that makes it cheaper again.
That's great. And is there a new clean tech that you are most excited about or that you kind of have your eye on right now?
Well, energy storage is the new solar.
Okay.
Solar and wind have been amazing, but just in the last couple years.
And so what is energy storage for people who might not know?
Yeah, energy storage is like batteries. The battery that you have in your phone, in your laptop, or in your car, perhaps, so you can take energy with you, or so you can use energy when you're not plugged into something right now.
Right.
Or so the sun doesn't always shine, the wind doesn't always blow. How do we use that energy after dark or on a still day? Right. And so that's why we need energy storage. And the price of that has plunged by a factor of 5 in the last 5 years as well. So we now have batteries are suddenly really cost competitive for certain grid power uses. And that's changing the game in energy as well.
And yeah, I've read some fascinating examples of energy storage in countries where, or like in parts of the world where it's challenging to have an energy source. Like, are there any examples of like innovative solutions to energy storage that you have?
Yeah, there's a lot going on. So in Southern California now, Tesla is building a giant bank of batteries for energy storage to help stabilize the grid and allow California, which has the most solar and wind deployed of any state in the US to use it more continuously through the hours of the day. Or in Australia, South Australia also has incredible sun, incredible wind. They've hit really high percentages of their grid being solar and wind. So they're also looking at energy storage. And Elon Musk actually tweeted, someone tweeted at Elon. This is the modern day. This Australian tech guy.
All the big updates from Twitter.
Well, a deal happened almost on Twitter. This Australian tech entrepreneur, Mike Cannon Brooks, tweeted Elon Musk, said, Elon, we need help in storage. You know, can your company hit this goal? And Elon tweeted back, we will build you this project within 100 days at this price, or you can have it half off.
That's amazing.
That's the modern era, yeah.
Wow. And so what are your hopes like in 5-10 years from now? What do you hope to see in clean energy?
We've always assumed that clean energy would be expensive energy. We should do it to cut pollution, to stop climate change, moral reasons. But I think in the next 5 years, it's just going to become completely obvious that because the cost of technology always goes down, that clean energy is the cheapest solution for getting energy, period. And that's going to, I think, be a sea change throughout the world in how we produce and consume energy.
And so there are ways that technology is really helping with environmental impact, but in what ways is technology harming the environment that you think maybe we should be aware of?
Whenever we use electricity, when we turn on our lights, whenever we drive our car, we have these emissions, right? And it's really obvious if you live in China or India, because you can see the smog that comes out. In the US, we mostly cleaned up smog, but carbon dioxide that causes climate change is invisible. So it's happening, but some people think, oh, we'll cut climate change by getting people to drive less, or to live in smaller homes, or to set up less. That's not gonna happen. People want what they want. So we have to innovate the technology to provide for our needs without polluting at the same time.
And so moving to science fiction, something that you are well-versed in, a lot of people are talking about science fictions becoming science fact. In what ways do you like science fiction as a tool for imagining new solutions, or like what draws you to science fiction as a tool for innovating and imagining new possibilities?
When I write science fiction, I'm free to write about things and possibilities that scientists aren't free to talk about themselves, right? I write sci-fi about the brain and about connections to the brain and sort of digital telepathy, and I have neuroscientists come to me and say, that's awesome. You're writing about things that I wish I could say, but they would sound too crazy for me to say. So that's one of the fun things.
So you like the freedom to just go to those places?
Yeah, exactly. So like Elon Musk's Neuralink and companies like that are doing the sorts of things that I was writing about in science fiction, early versions. But the other thing is that sci-fi really gets into the human element, right? Mm. Technology isn't just about technology, it's about what people want and what are they scared of. And so when you're writing characters and plots, it's all driven by people's desires, or their fears, or their needs, or their beliefs. And that's what actually shapes how we use tech in our world, how we use everything in our world.
Yeah, talking more about that, how science fiction hits on kind of like the human element of technology, are there ways, what are you concerned about with technology intersecting humanity? Or, there's a lot of science fiction that goes into these scary dystopian worlds.
Yeah.
Do you have any of those fears?
Yeah, I'm an optimist overall. I think throughout the history of the world, every technology we've made can be used for bad and good, but mostly they get used for good. But yeah, there are things that scare me. I'm scared of the surveillance state, of how easy it is for a small group of people to get information about all of us. Certainly the side effects of energy with climate change are scary things for us, and that has scary tipping points which the world can change really fast in a small number of years. The power of one person to destroy has gone up and up and up, and it will. We'll see things like drones used in terrorist attacks, that's for sure. But I also believe that we're smarter than we think, and that we will find ways to address those issues and to channel technology mostly to positive uses.
I think it's very true that we are smarter than we think, and oftentimes, like I think the title of your book, The Infinite Resource, there's usually a positive way to channel our intelligence and our energy, so that optimistic viewpoint. And so if you had one type of call to action to our audience, to participants at the conference, of how to become more engaged or take steps to make like more positive environmental choices, whether they're a leader in their organization or just in their own lives? What might that be?
I'd say go look at your energy use, whether you're just a homeowner or a business. Look at your energy. Where does it come from? What are you spending on it? And then go look and see, is there a cheaper source that's cleaner available to me? And would my customers like it if I could tell them your product is made with clean energy? Go understand that for yourself. I think you'll be surprised by how far clean energy has come.
And so I don't want to get too political, but right now, you know, there's so many shifts in the government in the U.S. And what is maybe a fear and an opportunity that you see in terms of the way government and policy is intersecting with clean technology?
Yeah. Well, I think at the federal level for clean tech, nothing great is going to happen. But I also don't think anything terrible is going to happen because clean energy is really quite bipartisan in the U.S. Climate change is a hugely politically polarizing issue.
Right.
But everybody loves clean energy.
Interesting.
And most of the action happens at the state level. So for states and cities, also hubs of innovation, there's an opportunity for states and cities to step up and really lead the way into the future and define the future in the energy space and in so many other things with technology.
Yeah. Well, on that note, thank you so much, Ramez. This is such a pleasure.
Awesome.
And enjoy the rest of your conference.
Thank you, Allison.
Thank you. Goodbye.